Hello and welcome to the 27th edition of Shardcast. I'm your host, Froetsylvania, and I'm bringing you a new feature to Shardcast. We're going to call this the Inside the Shards look in Shardcast. We're going to be featured with Outlandish Matt from the Threshold podcast as we take a look at his Round 7 matchup that he played in the Hex TCG Pro Challenge Series tournament. I'll bring him on in just a second. This is a match of the 7th round where both players were 3-3. He was facing Bravos. And just a second, I'll bring Matt in to see you guys. Let's get his audio set up here. And Matt, you there?
Yes, I am.
Excellent. Welcome to Threshold. Wow, there you go. Welcome to Shardcast. That's a good start there.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Not a problem. That being said, this is Outlandish Matt from the Threshold podcast. I was going to give you a couple quick interview questions here, kind of give the audience a brief synopsis on the Threshold podcast, if you don't mind, and then we'll get into your matchup.
All right.
All right. Well, first off, how did Threshold podcast start?
I guess it started with Josh Augustine, who does also Happy Hearthstone and some other podcasts, Wild Pet Battles and something else, I believe. And I've been in talks with Josh Augustine. He worked at PC Gamer. He did an interview with us for my other podcast, Outlandish. And when Hex got announced, he started talking about, you know, since Hearthstone was already in, I think, closed beta at the time, maybe. He started talking about how Hex was coming out, and he would maybe like to do a podcast about that as well.
Okay.
So I looked at the Kickstarter for Hex in the video, and I was just like, yes, this is like something I want to do. You know, like, I think we all got, you know, we all got hooked on it because we're either fans of Magic or we're fans of other CCGs,
mm-hmm.
and just the how it expands upon just CCGs in general with the PvE aspect and the PvP aspect.
Mm-hmm.
And it just became something that myself, Josh knew Jeff. I also knew Jeff through my other podcast.
Okay.
And, he's already doing a podcast of his own, ELO, and for League of Legends, and he's already in the podcast scene. And my other co-host, our fourth and final co-host, Eric Belsauce, was also with PC Gamer when they're doing their podcast. So it just all we all just come together. We all loved Hex, and that's how Threshold was born.
Good deal. Well, I know I personally enjoy listening to it every week and look forward to it. And you guys are doing a wonderful job over there. I know that you each have your own little piece that you enjoy about Hex, but what's the next feature you'd like to see them bring in?
I think draft. Everybody, I think, is looking forward to draft. I mean, I can't expect there to be. I mean, like it's like, oh, we brought. I don't know. Like with every other feature they bring in, it's all like, where's my draft?
Pretty much.
I want my draft. Give me my draft.
Yeah.
Like, you added three more cards. That's great. Where's my draft?
Where's my draft, Dad?
Yeah. So. that has to be like the next feature that everybody wants. I'm glad we got sealed.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get me wrong.
Oh yeah.
I mean, I'm thrilled that we got it. But I want my draft.
Of course. Now, does that mean you're going to be more of a PvP player, or are you going to look to go towards maybe the PvE route, or maybe a little bit both?
I think I'm definitely going to be both. Because like, you have all these quirky cards that are going to be great for PvE that will mm-hmm. let you, you know, take more chances because, you know, the AI might not be so brutal as a PvP player.
Right.
The decks might not be as, you know, hardcore, you know, win in turn 5.
Sure.
You know, so I definitely am going to be playing both. I personally kickstarted, I bought 2 pro player accounts.
Mm-hmm.
As I told people when I got them, I was like, you know, when Magic Online was in beta, if they would have given me the opportunity to do that, I would have jumped on it.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
You know, I think a lot of us are fans of Magic. We either played it at one point, we're playing it now. And to think, you know, if you had a chance to launch into Magic, you could say, okay, can you go to your card shop every single week and get in a free draft for just $250
mm-hmm.
anytime you want? We would all jump at that problem.
It would be absolute steal.
Yeah. So, I think I'm gonna be heavy on the PvP side. I'm hoping that Threshold will cover it a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And also on the PvE side for the raids and the cool creativeness, the keep battles and all that kind of stuff.
Sure. Now you had touched on just a bit with Threshold doing some of the PvP stuff. What can we maybe see for some future podcasts for Threshold, like some sort of topics or some content from them?
Well, I mean, there's so many things that I want us to cover. You know, I mean, we have, you know, once draft hits, I want to cover that. I'd really like us to go more in depth with Sealed. Just on strategies and hopefully, you know, over the weeks in which we all get a chance to experience more of it, because it does take a lot of time to, you know, try to get sealed in for, you know, because you got to set aside at least an hour and a half to play, you know, for the sealed part and all that. So hoping we can talk more about sealed, more about limited with drafts, also constructed. We had like a whole list of things that, you know, you put me kind of on the spot here.
Sorry about that.
No, that's all right. But I mean, you know, we talked about how the economy, you know, once they introduce the auction house, that's going to be a really in-depth discussion. You know, once PvE hits, that's going to be more stuff. You know, just as the beta progresses, as alpha progresses and we get into beta, you know, every week it seems like there's going to be topics to talk about, especially with the Kickstarter every Friday update that they have. That's just, you know, topic right there.
Mm-hmm.
And we just covered, I don't know if you saw the forum posts about, Glark, I think, or something like that. I can't remember the guy's, it's something Ark, I think it's Dan Clark, but he talked about the economy.
Right.
And a little bit, and also the rarities that we're going to be seeing, such as, I believe legendaries are 1 in 11 right now. So that was a topic for us to talk about this week, is, you know, what, you know, the rarities and all that kind of stuff that we hope to see, and primal packs, and, you know, what the rate of that's going to be like.
Yeah, the primal packs will be outrageous. I can't wait till I open my first one of those.
So every week it's a new topic for us. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you're going to see that in your Kickstarter rewards and stuff like that. So
now you said you got,
you know, every week.
Every week thing. Well, like I was going to say, you mentioned every week. Now, if people aren't listening to you currently, where can they find you guys?
You can find us on iTunes. Just search for Threshold, I believe, in the podcast section.
Okay.
You can also get us directly from our website at thresholdpodcast.com.
Okay, perfect. Well, I appreciate you having this little interview segment with me so we can ask you a couple questions and get some insight into you, into the Threshold podcast. And if you're set and ready to go and ready to get at it, we'll go ahead and start looking at your round 7 match if you're ready. Do you have that pulled up ready to go?
Thing. All right, let's go ahead.
All right, let me get you over there real quick. And again, this is the round 7 matchup between Threshold and Braavos. So I believe Braavos was actually, what's his name in the actual tournament?
That is Crone.
Crone, that's right. That's Crone. Vincent, right?
It's Vincent. I'm not sure if it's Crone NL on there, but I think it's just Crone.
Okay. All right, so you look like you tossed the first hand there and keeping the second. This is your mono blue deck, correct?
That is correct.
Okay. So you decided to keep 2 Sapphire Shards, a Counter Magic, a Mimic, and 2 Buccaneers? And
yes.
What was the your plan of attack here? Did you happen to see any of Braavos' games, or was it one of those where you're kind of just going with what your deck is?
He was a tricky fella and did not have any past broadcasts. So
oh, that's fun.
I could not watch any of his other games. Because that's the thing with the tournament is you can't different time zones and everything, so you might not be able to catch people when they're streaming.
Good point.
So and I want to point out, like, looking at the hand, the first hand, I really didn't like it. You know, I had double or triple Eldritch Dreamer.
Yeah, it was like I think it 2 in there.
I threw it away. And then I got that second hand, and I was like, man, I kind of wish I would have kept the first. Because I think I had an Ancestor's Chosen in the first hand. So I pitched it.
Okay.
And I was okay with this hand. I mean, you know, you don't ever want to keep a 2. You really don't want to keep a 2 shard hand.
No, especially not when you're. It's better with a mono color than it is with a dual color.
Yeah, I had the 2 shards, and I had the counter magic and the 2 buccaneers, so I was hopeful that I would draw a third shard for to have those 3. Because I was like, okay, 2, you know, maybe 2-3 turns, I can have my mana. So my resources.
Definitely. Now, what was your thought process when he decides to drop an Ancestor Chosen on the board now? So now you know he's playing Blood Sapphire.
Yeah. I wasn't too worried about it.
Mm-hmm.
That was good. I would definitely rather see Blood Sapphire than just straight Blood,
mm-hmm.
personally, honestly, or Blood Ruby.
Blood Ruby can be a little rough. So you're going to play your Buccaneer here and bounce the Chosen, which will keep him from putting the Spectres in his deck.
Yeah, I would definitely want to stop that, slow it down. I don't want to race the Spectres.
No, not at all. Those can get way out of hand when they start to get going, too.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that being said, now there has been quite of the chatter on the forums about the randomness of the Scheffler and the card packets, mm-hmm. if you will. What is your personal opinion on that? I know that they've had plenty of research out there. Are you still a believer that's random, or do you think there's a conspiracy going on here?
I think it's fine. We had a discussion about that a little bit on Threshold, because I think at one point it was rumored that, some of the escalation cards might get put at the bottom of the mm-hmm. deck or something like that. So I'm fine with it. I mean, cause I don't know them, none of us know the codes.
Right.
So you just have to put faith in it.
Okay. Yeah. I've discussed it a couple times. I think it comes down to the fact that we're used to human randomness, if you will, which isn't true, computerized random. So now you're playing, you're playing one incantation as you use the Curse of Oblivion against it. Now, I know you've been on the fence about the incantation cards.
Yeah. Well, I put that in right before the game. Like, I took out two, the Eldritch Shield, I think is what it is.
Yeah, the Spell Shield card.
On the title of that.
Is that the one that gets? Yeah, the one that gets Spell Shield. Sure.
Yeah, for two resources,
mm-hmm.
and I took those two out. They were late game additions after my last game, and I was like, you know what? I'll put in the incantations.
Okay.
I almost took out the two mimics I play for the 3 and 4 of the incantation, but I decided against it because I really like mimic. And mimic is good in games where they have something you can't deal with or something,
right.
So you can just copy their big creature.
Yeah, and it'd also help you win the last game as well if I'd remember casting that one.
Yes.
So. But
incantation is so powerful.
Right.
Like, you'll see me later up be like talking to Crone about how mm-hmm. it's so powerful.
Yeah, now I know that I am not an avid user of it because the colors I normally play, usually play white and red for the most part, and their incantations mm-hmm. are a little bit tricky to get to. And do you think there's enough balance between the five, or does there need to be more balance, or what do you think about that?
We talked about that in depth on, because we made this incantation our card of the week for this episode, this next week's episode of the podcast.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like the card, with the +2/+2 for each card in your hand, and the fact that it has speed when it transforms,
right.
Like, the reason for me saying it's too powerful against Crone here is because his aside from murder in his deck, that's mm-hmm. all he has to deal with. He has nothing else. Like, his persecutes aren't going to do anything
nope.
against it, really. His extinction, he has to wait until his turn to do it.
Right, which is already
so
swung
no
at you.
So there's no response, really. So that's why I was saying to him, it seems too powerful against him.
Now, I do have a question. Now, Alarin, who you played against last round, who I actually know in real life, he's my mm-hmm. buddy that I work with, we were kind of bouncing the idea, and here's your question about the incantation. Now, we were actually bouncing the idea of maybe that when it does transform into a troop, this would go across all five incantations, that when it transforms, it actually exhausts when it transforms. Would that be something that maybe balances it out more?
Yeah, I mean, I had talked about how I don't think they're supposed to have the speed because, the red one, the ruby mm-hmm. one has speed.
Right, so it kind of defeats the purpose, ridiculous. Right?
Yeah, so I think you're going to see in the next, patch, they'll probably make it so that they don't have speed. But then again, wouldn't that hurt all the other transforming, troops?
You would think so. My exclamation I've kind of concocted in my head, which means it could very well be completely wrong, is that because the constant was in play for more than one turn, that's why it doesn't mm-hmm. suffer from the troop trauma. That being said,
correct.
That being said, though, it's still broken. I've seen a Incantation of Fear go from zero counters to five on the turn it was played and actually start swinging. So it's broken either way. But looks like we have Thorla Fools is actually in the stream right now, and he says he thinks the Wreck Incantation is pretty good. And
I'm not gonna say it's not good. I just think it has a wasted ability.
Yeah, and like, Silent Monk actually
something else.
Silent Monk actually retorted with saying it was the worst incantation. So I think it's to the beauties in the eye of the beholder. I believe in this case.
Yeah.
All right.
I mean, I'm surprised it doesn't have Swift Strike.
That would make it much better card. Now you took a few seconds to think here. What's your thought process in this here? You've got two Mimics and a Buccaneer, and I think you're trying to decide which one to play here.
Let me catch up to you right now.
Okay.
What minute mark are you at?
I am at 9:28 and counting.
Okay. All right, so...
you decided not to play
any one of them. Two Mimics?
Yeah, you got two Mimics and a Buccaneer, and you didn't play anything. So I'm guessing you're waiting on counter magic, I'd imagine.
Okay. Did I play the Elder's Dreamer?
No, you did not.
Oh, okay. I didn't play anything.
No, you didn't play anything.
I guess? Okay. I want to leave counter magic up.
That's the only thing I was thinking, maybe.
There's no, because at this point I was thinking, you know, there's nothing he can do to my incantation. All I'm waiting for, he's got two Ancestor's Chosens. I'll take two a turn.
Mm-hmm.
He has no responses to my incantation. Like he can't counter magic. He can't, you know, he's not playing any bounce. So there's nothing he can do against my incantation. That I worry about on my turn.
Gotcha.
So I'm just holding cards, building up for when the incantation goes off.
There you go. Okay, so here you go down to 15. He's at 17 here. You're going to draw a card.
Okay.
Once the phase goes through here, you drew another counter magic. So this time you decide it looks like you're going to play the Dreamer probably. You're thinking about it.
Yeah, because he doesn't have... I realized at some point here that he doesn't have the second Sapphire
mm-hmm.
for counter magic.
Gotcha.
So I'm not worried about him ever countering anything. So I might as well take a risk.
Yep, so you drop the Dreamer on the board now. Now, how do you feel about the Dreamer being the only unblockable troop? We had a conversation about that work the other day. I mean, obviously the only one in this set that we've seen so far, but...
Yeah, well, I thought... Elder's Dreamer is like top five card, you know, like mm-hmm. It's like number one or two in my Sapphire because I feel like he's strong. He's a 3/3 for 4 with a socket major. So automatically he's going to get the draw a card probably on him, which to me is like super strong. It's going to be, I think, you know, once they get the prime ruby one where whenever it deals damage, you discard and draw three or something like that. Is that right?
Yeah, I think they have
your opponent.
I think your opponent has to discard three.
Okay. Yeah, I think that might be kind of strong. Mm-hmm. I just think the unblockable and a socket major is pretty. It's a pretty big deal.
Yeah. Now we were toying with the idea of maybe dropping him to like a 3/1. That way, you know, he's in range of pretty much every removal spell out there, just to make it to where he's, you know. I just think I'm with you. The socket and the unblockable seems like it's too much.
Yeah, if it was a socket minor,
mm-hmm.
It probably wouldn't be so bad.
So Bravo.
Yeah. So.
I say it looks like he just concedes here. He's like, I'm not even gonna block.
Yeah,
even,
I mean,
can't do anything about it.
Yeah, I knew as soon as like there wasn't much for him to do with that. Incantation.
So we'll
and at
here.
That point, I didn't even.
Oh, go ahead.
I didn't know that he was. You know, I didn't know he was playing murders.
Mm-hmm.
I assume that pretty much murders aren't being as heavily played as they were before. Because of the whole they can't destroy artifacts now.
That actually came back to bite me earlier this morning. I was playing in my match and he dropped a Guardian. And I had no way to get rid of it. I understand what they're trying to do with murder, but... All right.
I definitely see a lot more Eternal Guardians being played now.
Oh, sure.
Than I was earlier.
Does that mean you've got Chaos Key is going to be a stronger card, do you think? Does it get main deck
now?
I
think you'll definitely see Chaos Key probably being played one or two of now, just main deck, because in case of Eternal Guardians, possibly. I've seen some people playing Argus, which, I mean, you know, if you're playing Hex Engine or something like that, you can get them out there pretty strong. I'd definitely like to see Argus be played more.
Sure.
I think Argus is a pretty decent card.
Let's see here. Now you've got a pretty decent hand set up here. We've got Time Ripple, Buccaneer, Mimic. You just drew the Eldritch Dreamer, or you actually just drew the Mimic. Eldritch Dreamer and Mastery of Time here. So what's your thought process? Where are you going with this hand?
All I saw, last game was Ancestors Chosen, Curse of Oblivion. Yeah, I didn't see much troops. The Time Ripple, I'm not really sure. I'm like, I don't know what I'm going to be doing with it.
Right.
I just know that I just got to stick to my game plan of, like, normally just putting out stuff and trying to bounce back whatever they play.
Okay.
I do know he is playing Persecutes.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I have seen a Murder or an Extinction.
Yeah,
so,
I think probably
I mean, if you're playing Blood, you're probably playing Extinction.
Oh, yeah. I've seen very few decks, Blood decks, that don't have Extinction in it. All right, so you're going to drop the Chosen here, which is not a bad play at all. Leaves you the Time Ripple in case he throws something else. So now the grand question is going to be, you were mentioning rarities on the top end here of the segment. Ancestor Chosen is a rare card, but I don't see him as being an expensive rare card. What do you think?
You mean monetary?
Monetary, yeah, monetary. When we actually get rolling here and we get ready to go, do you see Ancestor Chosen being a top tier rare card, or is it gonna be one of those you can probably find for a buck or two on the auction house?
I think it's a staple.
Mm-hmm.
In meaning it's whenever you play Sapphire, you're probably gonna put it in your deck.
Okay.
Because there's nothing wrong with drawing a 2/2 flyer for one that draws a card.
Oh, not at all.
You know?
I'm not gonna turn that down.
So I think it will definitely be up there. It would be, but I think, I mean, heck, we talk about, you know, monetary wise, rares. I mean, what's going to be the top end of a rare price? You know, I mean,
right.
Like, because packs are only going to be $2. So, mm-hmm. I mean, who knows where six to eight maybe?
Yeah.
You know, I don't know where rares are going to end up.
I was just having to think about, like you just drove the missing Grok there in comparison. I imagine Missing Grok's going to be a beast of a card to get a hold of. He just seems to win games.
Now, is it a rare as well?
It is a rare as well, yep. Is it the blue symbol there at the bottom?
I would definitely have sideboarded out Missing Grok had we had the opportunity for sideboards.
Mm-hmm.
Now, at this point, I'm really dreading the fact that I haven't drawn a short.
Oh, yeah, because now you're filling up with 4 and 5 drops. Yep, here's your comment to Bravos here. Now I'm chart screwed. go ahead, sorry.
Well, I really would have liked to have dropped that Eldritch Dreamer that turn.
Oh, sure. I was going to comment how I've done this, like I said, this is the 27th Shardcast, and I think the mass majority of them, you see very friendly, jovial banter between the players. And that's something that I think has been missed from a lot of the online games in general in recent memory. There's that Chaos
Key. Well, we are
in
alpha right now.
This is true. We've all paid money for this game. So, this is true. I will give you that. But I also, to that token, I expected to see people who, I don't want to say are the elitists, if you will, but I sort of expected to see a few of those.
Yeah, I mean, as we roll along into beta, we might start seeing it. At this point, I realize, crap, he has three open. He has three open resources. You know.
Yeah, that always feels good.
That's
doesn't
the
it?
One thing I. It's like ah.
Now, a question. I know I probably wouldn't have done it either, but the thought process between not countering the Chaos Key, because now you know anything you put down is an instant target, and he's easily ahead of you in shards now.
Mm-hmm.
So
I just figure, you know, what's the worst? You know, I mean, like, I guess I was thinking, like, incantation, he gets rid of the incantation. That's mm-hmm. pretty much what he's put it out there for, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'd rather much hold on to the counter magic for something else.
Okay. Yeah, like I said, I don't disagree with you. I probably wouldn't counter it either. But just for those maybe who maybe don't play control, don't play counter magic, you know, we had just talked about the Chaos Key being something that's mainboarded now for all the uses it could have. So I just kind of wanted to go over that real quick, the thought process.
Now, I will say I just regretted not countering his Oracle Song. I don't know what was in my head at the time, because I should have countered it.
Mm-hmm. Maybe you said, I'm not going to counter that. I'm going to counter what he's going to play in response.
Yeah.
All right, so there's your one of your specters. So like savvy TCG players do, you swing first, play second. For those of you watching at home, if you're trying to learn how to get a little bit better, take one extra step towards being better. Always attack first if you possibly can. Now, surprised you didn't counter that with the chosen putting all the specters in your deck. Now they all come out.
Yeah, once again, I was like, you know, I'd much rather keep the counter magic for something else, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, oh, man, I got a discard.
Yeah, this always isn't fun.
Toss a time ripple, maybe. No, I toss the Grok. That's what I toss.
Yeah, because you just talked about sideboard.
Yeah, Grok was pretty much like, you know, haven't seen any troops. Mm-hmm. It's not going to help me.
All right, so he's up to six resources now. This is where you start smelling Life Siphon and even Sadistic Castigator and your Uranus.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and I think that's the main reason why I held on to the counter magic. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not sure if I think it was in the first game where I saw him discard an Uranus.
I must have missed that.
I believe
I didn't
he pitches
see it.
An Uranus.
Okay.
Because I definitely saw an Uranus get pitched in the first game, which is why I am later on playing a certain way. So
okay.
So Extinction, I could have countered. Do I counter this?
You do counter this.
Do I counter?
Which I don't blame
you.
Okay,
I do counter this.
This leaves your pressure on the board, and he's out of resources anyway.
Yeah, and it also ups his Extinction to six casting cost, and right now he's at seven, so if he Extinctions again, you know, he won't have resources to counter magic in response to that, to anything I might do.
Right. Now, do you think they've gone a little overboard with the adding of the casting cost on almost all of the control cards, if you will, in Sapphire? Because you've got your counter magic, you've got your time ripple, you've got your Buccaneer. They all add casting cost.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that you think is a good thing, or maybe it's a little bit too stifling for the competition?
I don't know. I haven't really put much thought into it. I mean, I think counter magic's super strong because it does up by two.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I mean, I haven't really put much thought into that.
Because at this point in time, it seems to be the only card that really increases your opponent's casting cost, and it's three different cards in the set. Take, for instance, you know, they're running an aggro deck. You time ripple their card on turn two. You time ripple again on turn three. You let it hit on turn four and then buccaneer it. I mean, at this point in time, you know, you've basically taken three of their turns away. In addition to controlling the board state.
Mm-hmm.
So you're going to swing for three here. Go down to 15, or he's going to go down to 15. When do you play your Dreamer? Are you going to play him now? You get two copies of him.
Well, yeah, I did not want. I was comfortable. I'm like a three, you know. If he does try to extinction again, I don't want him to, you know, three for one me.
Right.
So I felt comfortable with just having just the three damage coming across every turn. I'm not one to ever like to overload the board.
Right.
Just for the fact that you have extinctions. So I'm thinking here, I'm like, I could play the Dreamer. He's at 0/7. But there is a chance with his card drawing that he could have another extinction.
So you're saying there's a chance.
Also, if I do the Dreamer. Yeah. If I do the Dreamer, he could also chaos key it. So.
Mm-hmm. I can't remember. He's got enough of that. Now, did it ever cross your mind to ripple the chaos key?
Not really. I more think along of time ripple for evasion so that I can get my guys through.
Okay.
I did think time rippling my Spectre.
That would be a bad play.
So I can draw another card.
Sure. I think you're just now seeing people do that more often as bouncing their own troops. They've gotten so used to using those control cards to bounce opponent's troops where it's like, hey, I could set this combo up pretty nicely just by bouncing my own troop. Alright, so he plays...
I think that was a murder. He just... If you notice, next time he plays Peak,
mm-hmm.
you're going to see that it pulls it from the deck and the card faces you.
Does it really?
Like... You actually get a preview. if you can recognize the art.
Real quickly, get a quick flash across the screen.
Yeah, if you can see where the Hex Alpha
little logo
emblem
there.
Is in the mm-hmm. upper by the deck.
Sure.
Yeah. If you look there, you might see the card like face you.
All right, so you're swinging three again. He's gonna go down to 13 this time. Mm-hmm. Are you getting worried that you're not swinging fast enough? Or you're pretty comfortable in your control set here.
I'm pretty comfortable because you know last game I didn't see anything hardly.
Mm-hmm.
You know I saw the two ancestors chosen, and Urnaz get discarded, and I haven't seen much action from him right now except for like Peak, Oracle Song, you know, Extinction.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not. Too worried. I mean, if he drops something, I've got the time ripples, the buccaneers. So that's why I want to leave stuff back behind.
So that was an interesting play. How about him countering your ancestral specter?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you're going to take that every game, aren't you? I mean, let's have you counter one of the cards that really wasn't in my deck.
Although it did make it, all of them cost three now that were in my deck.
Yeah, this is true.
And I think I start looking, I'm like, oh, it made my one in play cost three now.
Yeah,
and now I was like, oh, time ripple now, it costs four.
That's what I was going to say. If you turn on time ripple, it's going to be much more difficult to bounce your own card there.
Yeah.
Now, for those of you who are viewing this as we're recording this live, if you have any questions for myself or even Outlandish Matt, feel free to go ahead and put them in the chat box there. We've got a little bit of time going through this game. We're going to keep asking Matt some questions about what he was going through here. Let's see if we can find what you're talking about here with this this quick look.
Okay.
So he's going to look at his cards. He looks at three of them. Yeah, see you pointing
Yeah,
up
so if
there.
you watch, yeah.
Well, maybe not
Oh,
that
okay.
time.
So it didn't do it that time.
Okay. It could have been also whenever it broke and he got all shards too, because there is that broken piece of peak right now. But yeah, if you are viewing this and you have any questions for myself or Ali and Ishmat, feel free to put them in the chat box. We'll try to get to them, get those questions answered for you. In the meantime, we appreciate you hanging out with us today or tonight, depending on where you're at. It is tonight where I'm at. Now,
This is tonight where I'm at as well.
this is true. It's tonight in large areas of the country. Now, Braavos has got 7 resources back and 5 cards in hand. How scary is that?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's scary, but at the same time, I've got, 3 damage on the board coming across. He has nothing on the board. I'm not too worried about it.
Okay. So, I guess here's a question for you then. Going back to that other trading card game that we try not to mention, that one that has 5 colors as well and that sort of thing. Now, what kind of player were you when you played that game? Were you a control? Oh, there's a little glitch. There we go.
Right, I want to just point out real quick. All right, so at this point right here, I have 2 Eldritch Dreamers.
Right.
I wanted to play one,
However,
but I was worried that he had a Curse of Oblivion in his hand.
and
And
that would
what Curse of
nullify the other one.
Oblivion does, it removes it. It would remove all of them from my hand, so it'd be a 2-for-1 pretty much if I played it.
Right.
So I was worried about that. I really think I should have played it probably. I could have had enough mana open to Time Ripple if he extinctioned. So I think that might have been a bad choice. I'm not really sure.
Okay.
Myself, in the other game we don't mention,
Sure.
apparently.
We can mention, I
I
don't
like how
care.
whenever Corey's being interviewed, he's all like, that other game, the other game.
Well, I am trying to get in good with Cryptozoics, so I don't want to tick them
As
off
if,
too much.
it's just fun. It's always funny how people don't mention their competitors, but yet we all know about them.
Well, it's what's made this game
So,
great too.
it is. So yeah, I pretty much was a combo player, so I would play. Pretty much, I mean, I play blue white,
Okay.
control with like draw go pretty much, where you would just counter stuff that they play and draw cards for yourself.
So this is right in your wheelhouse
I
then.
also, yeah, this is definitely right in there.
Okay.
I'm all over the board. Combo, I love combo. I'm really waiting for Eye of Creation to come into play.
Oh, that's gonna be such a great card.
It's definitely seen some changes,
Yeah.
but I'm looking forward to it.
So you let him wipe here instead of you look like you were thinking about bouncing your Spectre, but like you said before, it would make him a 4-drop then.
Yeah.
Is that why you decided to pass
Yeah.
on it?
Yeah. I have the 3 creatures in my hand, the 3 troops, the 2 Eldritch Dreamers. In my hand, I wasn't too worried about board. Luckily, I drew into the Elders Chosen. I was hoping to maybe bait something out with the Elders Chosen, but I did not.
Not successful.
I probably should have played a Buccaneer right there. Would have still had enough mana, enough resources to Time Ripple if he did anything.
Okay. So here you do Time Ripple, which is a pretty. I agree with this play, big time, because now you can turn around and play it back out, and you still get your cards.
Yep.
All right. So now that you spent a murder, do you feel a little more comfortable
If
playing
I'm not
your?
mistaken, if you look at his hand total, it's 4 right now. If I'm not mistaken, is it when that resolves it, does it go down to 3? No, okay. I've noticed some little glitch stuff where it's hard to keep up with hand totals.
Okay.
I've loaded up against myself. So I have, since I have the two accounts,
right.
I do a lot of play testing for like bugs and stuff.
Yeah, we saw your Ozawa testing. That's been all over the place.
Mm-hmm. So,
thanks for breaking the game, Matt. Appreciate
that. I noticed that the hand sizes are kind of hard to keep up with at times. So, I've been trying to watch that.
Okay.
Every now and then.
Now, I did notice another bug this morning that my play clock as I was playing. Ooh, hold on a second before we get into that. I want to know your thought process and what you would discard now.
Okay. Yeah, I probably. Now, this is where I should be like. The problem is that I kept thinking about Uranaz. Like, I keep thinking, if he has Uranaz in his hand, I like, about the best thing I can do is mimic it,
uh-huh.
And then time ripple his, and then mastery of time or something like that.
Sure.
Like, all I can think is, like, you know, I need, so I don't throw away the time ripple, the mastery of time, or mimic.
Uh-huh.
Instead, I pitch a dreamer. Looking back on it, that was a terrible choice.
It's always better when you watch it back. Always better when you watch it back. Oh, not what I was saying this morning about the time clock. In my game when I was playing, and I played against Cirrus this morning from Hextex. Played him this morning, well, this afternoon about 1 o'clock. My time clock kept running during most of his phases. I almost timed out during my first game. I was down to like a minute and a half left, so that's something that me being a bad beta tester or alpha tester have not put it on the bug form yet, kind of because I was waiting to see how that, if they were going to get that bug form, that new form they have fixed, so. But I do need to list that in there.
No, yes, you should.
Yes.
Everybody should be listing bugs in there.
Yes.
So I just attacked with the Ancestors Chosen.
Mm-hmm.
I would much rather be without my Ancestors Chosen and him without the 2-1 flyer that I can't do anything about.
Mm-hmm.
Than because I'm not gonna Buccaneer. I'm not gonna bounce a giant corpse fly back to their hand.
Oh no.
That's not good for anybody.
That's not good for
anybody.
Well,
it's not good for me.
Well, it's good for him.
Yeah. So I would. Yeah, I would much rather trade my 1-1 because he could outrace me. I mean, he's going to be doing 2 while I'm doing 1. Mm-hmm. So I don't. To me, if I was him, I would have just took the 1, and I'd just start swinging with the 2-1. But you know, he went a different route. I would always let somebody deal 1 damage to me while I'm dealing 2 damage to them.
Oh sure.
So.
But now you've got the time.
I'm not really sure, like, why he felt. I didn't really understand why he felt like he needed to block it.
Yeah, he's still got 11 health left, yeah. So now you're going to sit on your time ripple because this Chaos Key coming out. So I didn't have to ask you that question. You knew that was coming. So,
and once again, I hold on to the time ripple.
Please tell us why. Please tell
Once
us
again,
why you didn't take
I was
your
living
dreamer.
In fear.
Please tell
in
us
fear.
Why.
Like, I have no answer to Uranaz, like except for that counter magic in my hand. I guess
yeah.
I should have. You know, looking at it, he has 5 resources. He could not have played Uranaz, so mm-hmm. I should have time rippled. I mean, there's just you'll see at the end of this match, I'm very regretful of some things in this game, like just more so than any of the games I think I've played in this tournament. So
I was about to say, because you didn't seem, you were playing this almost as I same identical deck on the last cast in the last round, and you didn't seem nearly as tentative.
Yeah.
You also got a little.
I just hate playing against blood.
It can be a beast.
Playing against blood is just, you know, it's pretty difficult because of all the removal.
Oh yeah, definitely.
And especially now, when your strategy of bouncing back their troops doesn't really work.
Right, because they don't have any troops to bounce.
Yeah, you know, it's like, yeah, or the troops they do have, you don't want to bounce.
Right, exactly. Now, Heavy Hitter like, mentioned in, hold on just a second. Heavy Hitter in the chat says you can counter magic this. Which play were you referring to there, Heavy? Sorry, go ahead while he answers the question there.
He was probably referring to, what was he referring to?
Probably when he was trying to count Chaos Key? I don't think you can counter magic the Chaos Key because it's an activated ability.
Yeah, I don't think you can actually counter magic the activated ability.
Yeah, because I think the counter magic actually raised target card and not. I don't think you can. Or if you can, you shouldn't be able to. Let's put it that way. Yeah, it says interrupt target card. So you shouldn't be able to. But we'll see if Heavy chimes in here. So now you guys are racing the opposite direction. Where you're dealing two, and actually more than that, the Thunderbird gets going. Alright, so back to the reporting of bugs. That should be addressed. I think, I believe it's Josh Augustine in your podcast. He's the one with EverQuest? Isn't he the one always harping about us not being good alpha testers? So I'm going to give him a free PSA.
I'm also harping about it.
I know you are. I'm going to give a free PSA here. Okay. Heavy Hitter just responded. The Chaos Kit goes on a stack. It can't be. Actually, it should not be. If it can, it's broken. The reason it goes on the stack is because activated abilities go on the stack now. That's correct. It goes on the stack. But the way that counter magic reads is it's interrupt target card, but shouldn't be able to. So we might want to actually test that as good alpha testers. But yeah, it's a good PSA for alpha testing. If you find something that may be broken, you need to report it. I was a self-proclaimed bad alpha tester today. Found a bug at 1 o'clock today and didn't report it as of, what are we running on now? 9 o'clock? So, the life siphon here. You think about countering this?
Yeah, at this point I'm like, yeah, I'm definitely thinking about countering it. I know he has counter magic up, but, you know, in this game, you can't double counter magic, which they really need to address that.
They do.
So I'm like talking to him, I'm like, is it for six, I guess? I mean, I can't look at his resources, but I think these cards should point out how much there should be like a number on them or some way for you to tell how much resources they've pumped into it. Besides, because I mean, if he played something else that turn, you know, how am I supposed to know that? I mean, like, am I supposed to just start doing math?
I need to bring my calculator to my hex game next time, just so I can keep track of all this stuff. No, I agree with you. I think it could very easily be put something. I know they wouldn't like to put some over to the card art, especially since Life Siphon is going to have something every single time. They could almost put a number up in the top right hand corner of the art that says six or something, you know, that lets you know what it's doing. All right, so you're going to counter this.
I'm going to counter it. I think he's going to, if I'm not mistaken, curse in response.
Yeah, that's not a bad play.
Mm-mm. And if you'll notice, look how many cards I have in my hand right now.
I see that. Four, but it says five on your champion there.
Yeah, and at this point, I try to time ripple.
Yeah.
I try to time ripple my counter magic.
You could try it. Why not? It's not a troop.
It does say time ripple.
Oh, that's right. It says target card.
Says put target card.
Yeah, that's right. It doesn't say where
and
it's located.
I was like, oh, let's see. I mean, yeah, it doesn't specify where.
it just says.
So I'm like, hey.
It just says put target card in its owner's hand. It doesn't say it has to be in play. It could be from the graveyard.
Yeah. I think, you know, me.
We need Errata here. We need an Errata here. Judge. All right, so
it does not say what zone it has to be in.
It does not. That is a true statement, sir. True statement. All right,
how does counter magic actually read?
Counter magic, let me pull that up for you real quick. Counter magic actually reads. Okay. I had it pulled up just a second ago. It says interrupt target card. Hold on. I don't know if I can get my fingers to type here.
I mean,
interrupt target card. Each card in an opposing zone with the same name as that card gets a permanent cost of +2. So it's interrupt target card. I mean, so I can.
I'm going to make a stance here. Time Ripple should affect things on the stack.
It should, because it
on
says
the chain.
It says the same thing that... It says the same thing.
It says target card. It does not say, like, where it has to... It doesn't say in play... I mean, that, or they just need to clarify Time Ripple.
Right.
And just say, put target card in play.
Right.
So, yeah, I should have been able to do that.
That sounds good. I think we need to get Shaggy on here, or get, I'd love to get Corey on here. We say, look here. Come on. Get this together. I know it's alpha, but come on. We're confused. Why does this work? Why doesn't this work?
So, at this point, I was thinking about Mastery of Time.
I saw that.
I saw you had three resources up. I didn't want to get counterspelled on that. I really want the Mastery of Time.
Right.
In case I need it for really something. I probably should have played it right there.
No, because you could have Mastery of Time and mimicked your Thunderbird and been swinging for the win. In theory. Because you had nine resources and... So in theory it would have worked, but I'm with you though. If you see those three resources up, anytime you see any Sapphire Threshold, Time Rip would be very good if you could use on anything in the zone. So Thorlefools, I hope I'm pronouncing his name right, agrees with you, Matt. Time Rip will be very good if you could use anything in any zone. Grum chimes in and says it would be overpowered. Sir Grum.
I'm not denying that.
You're not going to have any denials from this side of the table. So you thought about time rippling your Thunderbird. Why not? You playing a fear?
That was another bad play.
Okay.
Yeah, I am. Because I'm like, he's got two cards. If he drops Urnaz at any time, like, that's only one card he has left. Also, I have enough resources to where I can, you know, mimic Mastery of Time. Mm-hmm. Then the next turn, I can time ripple Mastery of Time. You know, I'm just thinking, like, it'd be great if he Uranaz, you know, or...
Right.
And I'm just living in fear. And that's... I felt like I should have been way more aggressive at this point. Like, looking back at my stream, I was like, I should have been way more aggressive.
Right
there.
Yeah, I was going to say, that hurts. Giant Corpse Flight. Yeah. I hate that card. I really do. I mean, it's not overpowered or anything. It's not. It's just a menace. It really is. It's just a menace.
Yeah.
All right. So, I want to give a quick shout out to the people who are sitting here hanging out with us tonight. I've got Heavy Hitter, TJ Taylor, Kibblenator, Sir Grum, Silent Monk, Thorlefools, and Wartesque. Again, I'm here with Outlandish Matt from Threshold Podcast, and we're doing a new feature on Shardcast called Inside the Shards, where I pick Matt's brain and figure out why he's playing in fear every other turn. At least that's where we've resorted ourselves to at this point in time.
Yeah, you look like probably like the best thing I could have done right there is pitch Time Ripple, mimicked his Giant Corpse Fly, making him discard one.
Right.
Or let's see.
I was gonna say the same exact thing as mimic his Corpse Fly.
Yeah.
Because he's only got two cards in here. You get rid of one of them. That will tell you a lot about what he's been holding on to.
Yeah, he'll either counter magic it, which that gets rid of the counter magic,
right.
Or he gets rid of whatever the other card is.
Exactly. So he's going to trade you here again. So now... He's got two cards, you've got three. Are you starting to sweat about Life Siphon yet? I know you countered it, so it's a 3x
now.
You
know, what's so bad? I totally wasn't even thinking about Life Siphon.
Oof.
Not even thinking about it. You know, I'm like, you know, it costs three. I don't know how many he's playing. Some people just play one of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think the chances if he's playing two, he's got, you know, one out of 30, whatever. You know, I mean, like, not even thinking about it.
At this point in your time, you're just playing the Grawp because you need bodies out there. You can always mimic it later if you need to. Or bounce it and play it again.
Right.
The fact that he let that land either said, hey, I have no troops to worry about it, or I don't have the counter magic.
Yep. Or he has an answer for it.
Yeah.
He's like, I got to persecute, I have a murder.
Something. So he doesn't play anything here. That's comforting, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's pretty comforting. At this point, since he doesn't do anything about it, I should really mimic.
Go ahead and put two of them out there. That way you can time ripple one of the two other out there.
Yeah.
I don't disagree with you.
Because,
here comes your persecute.
Because I want to, you know. Okay. At this point, I should time ripple.
Yeah.
Nope. Living in the fear.
I was going to say, because now you have nothing to mimic.
Living in the fear.
You have a mimic and nothing to mimic now. Wow. So those of you tuning in live and later on when this is posted, if you want to know how to play while living in fear, this is your prime example. Thank you, Matt, for tuning in.
I definitely make a point of, like, you know, what you have to start being aggressive at some point.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you can't.
Because he's going to draw into whatever
like
he needs.
This. You can't play on the defense.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm holding on to these three cards that could easily have prevented creature death or troop death or, you know, help me race.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, I'm like, okay, I need to figure out a way to handle Uranoz if that's one, if he draws it or, you know, something.
Yeah, because this time, if it's a one of in his deck, it may be at the very bottom of the deck. You're waiting 30 turns for it.
Yeah.
Okay, so here comes another extinction. Do you time ripple now? Do you time ripple? Come on. Nope.
You would think, right? You would think.
Because then extinction would have been an 0 for 1 at that point in time. You'd extincted nothing. Nope, you're going to let it hit. Good job. All right, so here comes one of your 3-cost specters.
Which that's something I think I mentioned right at some point here. I'm like, it's just a race for specters.
Yeah. So you're going to put more into your deck by putting a chosen back in there, which is good. Now you know he's played, what, 2 extinctions? Does he play 2 or 3 now? I think that's what we're looking for right now.
I think he's played all 4.
1, 2.
I think he's played all 4.
3. Yeah, he's played all 4 now, so you don't have to worry about that now. That's a good sign. Now you do have to worry about your clock. I just now noticed that as well. Murder? No time ripple? Come on. Time ripple? Get another card? No. Don't, let's not pull a cantrip back in her hand. That's not good at all. I can't say anything. Matt, you got a better record than
this,
I do, so I can't say anything about your play style.
I didn't know this stream was going to be all about Matt's bad plays.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the last time you'll see Outlandish Matt on a Shardcast. he was going to respectfully decline each invitation from there on out.
You know, it's just bad.
It takes a good player to admit when you're playing bad, though. I will give you that much. Good player to admit when you're playing bad.
Yeah, I mean, like, and I, going into other games past this,
mm-hmm.
I've realized, you know, I've not acknowledged I need to start playing more aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I have to, don't play as if they have something. Play what you know. Like, they have 2 cards in hand. Okay, one of them's probably a counter magic. Okay. So draw out that counter magic if you need to.
Right. At this point in time, I mean, I hate to make a bad poker analogy, but you're playing expecting them to suck out on the river. I mean,
yeah.
Instead of just pushing your chips forward and putting the pressure on him. But now he's sitting on a 2-turn clock because you got 3 on board. Here's another Spectre, so you'll swing here. I mean, at this point in time, a shard.
At this point.
And it's over if he's at Life Siphon.
Yeah.
So here comes your Spectre. Another Spectre. Now, why is that one only 1? Was that put in the... Oh, it was probably put in the deck after.
Put in there later.
Yeah, I was going to say put in the deck after. I didn't even think about that. So with now, no extinctions, you're swinging for win, right? Right?
Yep. Yep.
Unless, of course, he has the life siphon. Which would have been awful. That'd broke your heart, wouldn't it? He just said, oh, yeah, sorry.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Yeah, so, wasn't even paying attention.
This is an example of how Aaron doesn't always watch the games he's casting before he casts it. I want to keep the suspense there. But then it makes Matt feel like a wonderful guest at the same time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but Thorfels is asking the same thing. Why not mastery time there and go for the win?
Yeah, he was holding the counter magic and life siphon for probably like 5 turns.
Gotcha.
I watched his stream.
So he was waiting on
and
it then.
And the 2 cards he was just holding on to. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's where I go to say, like, I should have played way more aggressive looking back on the stream. Like, I should have just been, like, mimicking at some point. Especially after he had played the fourth extinction.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I should have just played more aggressive. At this point, I'm furious. I'm like,
you're
challenge.
Steaming on tilt. To answer, to Thorfels asked, why not master time there? Yeah, obviously that would have been a good play, but as Bravos went on to mention, he would have just countered it anyway. So it wouldn't have changed the outcome of the game.
So you keep should have tried to mastery a time a lot earlier.
Yeah. You got a 5 shard hand this time.
Yeah.
And you keep it.
Yeah, because I just don't want to take a chance.
Mm-hmm.
On getting a 6 card hand and getting 2 shard, two shards.
Right.
You always feel like when you see that many shards, you're like, I'm gonna be drawing nothing but.
No, right. Exactly. I've got a quarter of my shards already. There's no way in hell I could pull anything but troops now. And then first turn shard.
Yeah. There's.
Good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, oh, okay, I see. You immediately know how this game's going to go.
Right? You get that sinking feeling, like, oh, okay, yeah. All right.
Yeah, you're like, mm-hmm.
You've already resigned turn one. You're like, okay, let's just, how quickly can you kill me? How's this going to work? Oh, man. So those of you watching at home, I have, after recording this, I have already asked Athlanish Matt to be on another shardcast, and he has respectfully declined after the berating I gave him on the first shardcast. So, he says next time, don't berate him on how he plays. I was just joking, and he actually left. You could have timed that any better, Matt. You could have timed it any better. That is absolute comedy. I just said, I had literally just said, if you're viewing this on record and not live, I've already asked Atlantis Matt to be on a future episode of Shardcasting. He's respectfully declined due to my berating while he was on here the first time. And you dropped call. That couldn't have been better timing. Couldn't have been better timing.
Are we still streaming?
We're good? Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. I want to make sure you didn't lose your internet connection on the stream.
No, I got the whole stream, everything. Everybody watched you like drop the call and rage quit and flip the table and everybody saw all that.
Yeah, that's how I hate to say it, but sometimes that's how matches are determined, through like just you beat yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Oh
yeah.
That gets to you too. That eats at you, and that probably carries on throughout the rest of the tournament.
Oh, sure.
It's like third game, fourth game, fourth round.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be a downward spiral if you let it get to you. So you just have to learn from it. Remember what you did wrong against the deck, and mm-hmm. then if you face it again later on, try to remember, hey, this is what I did wrong last time I faced this deck. Let's not try to do it this time.
Sure. Yeah, I've often, because I played poker well before I started playing that other card game and this one. And I'm going to chuckle out of you every time. But no, it's I believe it wholeheartedly. You're playing the same sort of mind games where you're playing the person across the table or across the monitor, where you have to make sure you're in the right mindset. You go on tilt, if you will, and let it get to you. That's the third Oracle song, isn't it? Sorry. That's the third Oracle song he's played in like four turns. Sorry. Just so those of you home know, I'm actually paying attention.
What time stamp are we at right now?
We are at 59-16, 59-17. He's persecuting your Buccaneer and you're counter-imaging it.
My stream is going slow. Okay.
59-30.
Okay. I'm trying to keep a little bit ahead of you since mine seems to be lagging behind. So let's see here.
We are at 59-48 now. So you just now drew card for turn, playing Wyatt, do another time ripple. And your feed just went out. And it comes back. And you play your Dreamer. So
because I saw him at 0-5, so that's the best time to play something that you try to keep.
Sure.
Unfortunately, I didn't leave up enough mana for Ripple.
Which means he murders here. Yep. He's going to play his capability here, 21-17, Giant Corpse Fly, hate that card, hate it.
I was like, wow, I got shards out the wazoo.
Why not just get rid of one of those, right? I'll tell you what, I'm going to go back to Inquisition for just a minute. I know he hasn't played one of those, and really it's irrelevant to what's going on the board here, and then he just murdered your Dreamer. We had a scut, you had mentioned before, I believe it was before last podcast, threshold podcast, you wanted to know which new card you wanted to have talked about, and I'd mentioned on Twitter, talk about Inquisition. Fish Mom and I went back and forth about if it's overpowered or not. You guys talked about it. I've kind of come to peace with the decision that it's not overpowered. However, there's one caveat to it.
It's still a strong card.
Well, not just that. It's a strong card. I will agree with you completely. It's a common. If they change the rarity, I'm perfectly okay with it. But with it being a common, now's where I'm still going to be on the overpowered bandwagon.
So you think it should be an uncommon?
At least. Uncommon probably good. I think it fits real well in the uncommon slot. Uncommon.
Rare, you want it to be rare.
No, well, no, I don't. Uncommon's good. I'll be happy with uncommon. I think common's just too much, because then it's going to be all replaced in drafts. And that's way, way overpowered in drafts.
Definitely strong in draft, don't get me wrong.
So you let the Chaos Key hit the board here.
It'd probably be strong and sealed, too.
Mm-hmm.
I say it'd probably be strong and sealed, too.
Oh, yeah, I agree with you. So, I think if they bumped it to an uncommon.
We had talked about the sealed format a little bit this week and about how, what card you want to see when you open, when you open up your six packs.
Mm-hmm.
And I had gotten a Sabotage in mine. I was like, Sabotage is like amazing. And
oh, sure. Like, they don't play a 40 card deck.
Sabotage. And then like, to me, it's kind of crazy that, if you get some blue, you might as well try to go with the mill.
Oh, sure.
That's two every two turns, right?
Right. I mean, if you pick... Yeah, I was gonna say, if you pick up the blue mill card, the Escalation card. If you pick that up,
man, come on! Like we would talk about it like all the time, so It's like ridiculous. Are you talking about the Escalation one?
Yeah, sorry about that. I lost your audio there for just a second.
It's
Chronic Madness. That's what it is. Chronic Madness.
Chronic. Okay. But yeah, that card would be, granted, it's only going to have You know, like the one card probably is rare.
Which
But still, I mean,
they're dumping four? Just if you get
yeah,
it one
and
time.
eight the next time you see
Yeah,
them.
if you happen to
Yeah.
pull it two times, you're already dumping over a quarter of their deck.
I had felt pretty confident in the one cell that I played in because I had opened up on Sabotage. I'd opened up on Replicator's Gambit with an Oathinge.
Oh, there you go.
And I was like, man, fucking Replicator's Gambit and Oathinge? Man, that's gonna be amazing.
Now, have they fixed the
Needless
gambit
to say,
yet?
I lost that match.
Did you?
I'm not sure. I mean, I play like as if they have. They've fixed so many other things,
Yeah,
but I'm not sure. If they haven't, I think I've stated this a couple episodes ago on the podcast that if they haven't fixed a card, I'd really like to see it removed.
I agree. I agree.
I mean, if we know it's broken, then don't let's not let just remove it then until you
Right.
can fix it.
And here's the thing, I mentioned this in the I was getting set up, practicing a few times before my match today. And I was playing against someone who's playing a mono blood deck, and they knowingly put the Rage 1 gem in the Xentas Inquisitor. And I'm like, really? You know that's broken, yet you're gonna play it anyway. Like, come on. All right, so he's
Well,
trying
I mean, they
to.
probably don't know it's broken.
Oh no, I asked him. I said, is that the broken Rage gem? He said, yep. So, totally owned up to it. It sure is.
So what point are you at in the stream now?
Okay, I am at 105:15. 105:15.
Dang, man. I cannot keep up. Mine keeps dropping out. I just watched myself.
You
Want
know?
to since I knew I was losing, I wanted to counter his counter magic just to
Yeah.
draw. Oh yeah,
Just break it. Why not? You know it's broken. Go ahead. They left the left card in there.
I gotta game the system here. Yeah, I gotta game it.
Here's Matt's solution to everything. If you know it's broken, go ahead and play it anyway. They left it in there. Their fault.
I didn't know that that would lock up the game. I'm
Ooh,
sorry. I
my
don't keep
bad.
up with this.
Ignorance is the best policy. Isn't that what they
Okay.
say? All
I'll honor
right.
it then.
Let's see. Here's your Inquisition card. There you go. I knew it'd show up. I knew it'd show up. See, it's a common. Come on. That's gotta be an
You have to
uncommon.
counter it.
Oh yeah, you have to. 'Cause he's gonna take it anyway.
Mean, yeah, he's gonna take it anyway, so.
Yeah, you gotta make that uncommon. Come on. That
I really hate Curse of Oblivion. They should need to make that more, I think. They should make it cost like two or three.
I agree.
Because it's so
I'd be on board with
first
that.
turn. I mean,
I'd be on board with that.
just all you gotta do is leave one resource open to do it. Man, come on.
I would be on board with that. I'd be on that bandwagon. Go ahead, start that. Start the petition. Go ahead, troll the forums.
Yeah.
I'll be right there with you. All right, so you're in a spot here. You got 11 health. He's got 20. You got two time ripples and a mastery of time. And he's got a corpse fly swinging two at you each turn.
Yeah.
You're in a spot.
And there's like nothing I can do to that corpse fly.
No, because you don't
There's
want to
like
bounce them.
nothing I can do to that
You
corpse
know.
fly. Yeah. I can drop a Thunderbird, maybe. You
If you
know?
draw one.
Block. Yeah. I guess I think we might have seen a Spectre or two get put in there.
Yeah, before the Chosen came off the board. Yeah, because you're at 46
Yeah.
cards. I don't remember him drawing that many more than you have. Well, he pulled Oracle Song three times. So, there may be one or two in there. So you draw a shard, that helps.
And honestly, I'm not setting too bad, you know.
Not yet.
He's got two cards in hand. You know, I mean, granted, I have no removal whatsoever for that corpse fly harvester or giant corpse fly.
I'm not going to jinx you and say now you're in range of Life Siphon in one turn.
Life cycle.
Yeah, I'm not gonna do that to you again. I don't know how I jinxed you, even though it happened, 2 days ago, but I feel like I jinxed you. Matt's gonna go out on his next Threshold podcast and go, yeah, if you wanna get jinxed and lose your game, go on Shardcast. I'll do it for you. Okay, so by the way, since Matt disconnected from the call and came back, his voice is very low. Rotary volume is fine. So Grum chimed in. I haven't touched the volume on the Skype feed. So I do see where it's barely coming in from you. Let's see if
it's
I can't.
Barely coming in from me, huh?
Yeah, let me see if I can't turn you up just a hair.
Do I need to bump it up?
You might. Can you bump it up? You might need to bump it up a little bit.
Maybe I need to bump it up. I don't know why I'd need to bump it up. You need to bump it up.
I'll bump up your Skype. Hold on just a second. We'll do that. Here, let's turn you up just a hair.
Just bump it up.
Bump it up. How about that? We looking good there, Grum? We good now? Give him a test there, Matt.
Test, 1, 2, 3.
In the meantime.
Like a check?
In the meantime, let's see. You're going to time ripple. That's corpse fly. Pro.
There's not much
play.
I can really do.
No, you have to, because if he hits you, I mean, you're on a clock at that point in time. I mean, there isn't anything you can do. But to the outsider looking in, that's now the counter magic on the draw there is huge, because now you can just counter it when he brings it into play. So you couldn't have top decked better at that point in time. Okay, so that episode's better, great, awesome. So at least we'll be set up for when we do our a few minutes of closing when we get done too. So he's on a 20 turn clock. Count it down. Chosen for the win. Oh, and a Chaos Keys.
Yeah.
Chaos Keys the Chosen. Extinction for the Chosen. Time Ripple. Do it. Do it. No, he doesn't do it. Now, you got to hold on to the counter magic now for Life Siphon. Corpse Fly. No, yeah. You're going to lose it anyway, right?
Well, yeah, and he's at zero resources, so he can't count. I mean, whatever. I don't know why I say he can't curse it or anything like that, I guess. So.
Right.
Also, I'm in just defeated mode right now. You know, I'm just like, whatever.
Beating yourself up.
Yeah.
Mumbling to yourself.
I know he doesn't have much, so I'm like, I have to like stop like what little creatures he's going to, what little troops he's going to get on the board. So.
Yeah, because now he's got drawn to a Life Siphon. At this point in time, because you have his troops on lockdown, so have you pushed over the dog at this point in time? Have you gotten to that point of just frustration? Have you pushed over the dog and laughed at him? Have you gotten that bad yet?
It was pretty much at the start. You know, once I had the 5 shards,
yeah,
in the opening hand, it was like, oh my god, you know, this, yeah, I blew game 2. Of course, I would, you know, end up with a starting bad hand that I don't want to mulligan away. You know, and another thing I want to bring up, just thinking about it just now, is that I'd really like to start seeing them make it so that if I win the coin flip, I can choose.
Yeah, that's another thing.
Do I play first or I lose?
I understand that 98% of the time you're going to choose to go first, but there's times we don't want to.
Yeah. Like, you know, in limited formats, sometimes it's best to, you know, draw for,
oh,
you know,
sure.
Draw. Also, how about when I play best 2 out of 3, we don't do a coin flip on the second and third match.
Right? Losers should go first.
Know, third game.
That seems good. Hey, I know you just beat the crap out of me, but go first again. Seems good.
Yeah.
Now, why didn't you time ripple there? Why didn't you time ripple your dreamer?
He had, I guess, resources open for counter magic, so I don't know. Not to mention he also had the chaos key anyways that he could just cast on it.
True. Good point. Fair enough.
No,
I'm almost
so
afraid.
Like,
that,
you know, why am I gonna? Yeah.
I was gonna say I'm almost afraid for them not to mess with a coin flip at this point in time, though. As bad as that coin flip bug has been, it's been fine for a while now, but I mean, I'm afraid that they say, oh, but on games 2 and 3 it doesn't actually happen, and that doesn't happen ever, and then it breaks because it doesn't know who goes first. I kid. I think they're in great shape with Alpha at this point in time. They got a little bit of ways to go, but I mean, if you think of the way it was when it released back on October 9th, that was not even 4 months ago.
Yeah,
I just think they've gone leaps and bounds since then.
It's definitely come. Yeah. But it was weird. I mean, talking with Corey at Gen Con, it's a little disheartening that we haven't had draft yet. But
bring on the draft.
I mean, so much stuff has, you know, come up, and I wonder if they, you know, if they've hit some snags that they wish they hadn't hit, you know, with the whole, because I do like that they talked about how they've got the server set up, you know, running on like a minimum like server, trying to get the most they can with the code and all that to make sure that, you know, when they do go full, having a bunch of servers that, you know, we won't really run into downtime probably.
Right.
We won't have like a bunch of server problems.
Oh, sure. Yeah, I mean, that was definitely something that I mean, was it frustrating at first? Sure, but now you understand the thought process. Like, you know what? That's good. They'll know exactly what limits they have. Now you time ripple the Spectre. Next Threshold Podcast. All right, I'm going to start out by absolutely berating Fritzylvania because he has no response to this podcast. There you are. There it comes. Yes. Matt's fear validated. At this point in time, do you just concede? Do you just say, I'm just done with this? I'm over it?
No, I mean, he's got one card in hand. You know, he gets my Dreamer. I'm like, there's not, you know, Dreamer's three coming across. I think I might be vindicated with this draw here.
Okay. See what this draw is. Is this a Grawk? What is this? A shard. Not that draw.
Shard.
Huh? No, you gotta drop
but
the Spectre
that lets
first.
Me draw.
Yes, it does. You draw twice here because you got the Spectre and the. Now, why did the Dreamer go up on the stack?
It's Uranus has a problem like that.
Oh, okay. Ooh, incantation. That doesn't help you though. Here's your Thunderbird. You know, Mastery of Time, so you can get some card draw here, right?
Yeah.
Now it sucks when you have to use that for five cost card draw.
Yeah.
All right. Another shard. Boy, did you have like 15 shards this game? You just couldn't buy a break, could you?
Well, at least I had 10.
This is true. This is true.
You hold on to your shards when you don't need to play them, just, you know, to make think you might have a card.
Oh, sure. I know when when I was playing my match this morning, he had the only card he had on play was the Eternal Guardian. I started holding cards and resources, make him think I had a repel because I was playing white. Make him think I had a repel so he wouldn't swing with it anymore. Yeah, there's a little bit of gamesmanship there, so. Those of you tuning in now, there is a little glitch there with Uranus that the Dreamer's just going to hang out over there. Say hi. Mock you. Say, yes, I used to be your card.
That's where I hope. I'm like, oh, did it lock up?
Nice. Did it bug? Please? Because you're not conceding here, are you?
Please.
If he says, I would have won. Oh, no, I'm not conceding at all.
There's chances.
Oh, yeah. I could
at this point in my head, I'm thinking, like, I'm thinking arguments of, like, how I could get out of it.
Right.
I could grok. I could grok. I could then Mastery of Time.
Yes.
Then a mimic.
You didn't know it was in my hand.
And I'm like, yeah. You don't know. I have outs.
Right. Oh, man. And you're just like point, 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 point. It's like when you know your sentence is about to come up, you're on death row, you're like, I'm just waiting. Just waiting.
Yeah, I was surprised he did not chaos key. I don't know why. I was like, I would have chaos keyed.
The Thunderbird?
I don't know what the one card is. No, I mean, I would just chaos keyed one of them.
Oh, you're talking
Just
about that way, force the other one to
yeah,
block and
dead
get off the board.
make yeah make the board wipe.
Yep.
I mean, I'm gonna block anyway, so.
Right. Yeah, that would have been a bad play at all.
I like a clean board. I like a clean board. I always like seeing, you know, nothing on my opponent, so knowing that, you know, he's got one card in his hand, nothing on the board. I'm sitting pretty good.
Right.
Like, what, honestly, what could I play that could not, that, you know, could help me win on this game?
Right.
Down 6-18.
So now he's going to chaos key your
With
spec. No, what? Oh, in case you draw an Oracle Song or something like that. But you've got one card in hand. What's he worried about? I guess a blocker. That's odd that he chaos keyed your incantation.
I guess he's just afraid I'll have a. Yeah, I'd only have like 2/2 or like.
Yeah, it'd be 4/4 at that point in time. Oh, here's your Grog. There you go. There you go. You can get there.
Yeah.
Just keep drawing Mimics and Grogs and you can get there.
I'm set.
So you're saying there's a chance?
So if I just yeah, swing for 2 here, he's at 16, you know. I'm just 5-6 turns away.
Right? You just need. You've got those many Groks and Mimics in your deck. You're set. Because the bad part is you can't do anything about the Dreamer. It's not the Urnaz that's
Yeah,
bad part.
I
Bad
just
for you. It's the Dreamer that's hurting you.
no, yeah, I just gotta keep it locked down, which that Grok is like, yeah, okay, that does it. I'm like thinking, okay.
Ha 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 ha. I laugh at thee.
Heart of the cards, you know, I get a mastery of time
Right?
or a mimic. Mastery of time, then mimic or another Grok.
Gee, that sounds awful
It
familiar.
happens.
That does happen. It happened to you in the last round. I casted that happening. When instead of bouncing your own Grok, you turn around and said, nah, I'll let it stay. And I'll just draw a Spectre into a Mimic instead. I'll just top deck. Like a champ. Yeah, I did. I will. I don't know if you listened to that cast yet or not, but I will freely admit and apologize for the slight berating I did of your play in that into that game.
Yeah, I understand it. I mean,
Now, I mean, it's and people ask me. That's well, my wife. I say people. My wife, as she makes fun of me when I do this sometimes. So why do people watch you? Why? Can't they just watch people when they're doing their own when they're doing their own streams? I said. I can see all the angles when I'm not involved. When you're
yeah,
playing,
that's me too.
yeah, when you're playing, you're focused, you have a goal, you know what you're trying to do. You can't see all of the angles going on at once. Which goes back to what I was just talking about. I could see all you had to do was like, you know, bounce your Grok, play your mastery time, play the Grok second turn, and be good to go. That thought may not seem it because you weren't, you know, I don't know. Maybe I'm just trying to validate my 27 shard casts I've done. Not a waste of my time. Who knows?
I love because it helps people understand.
Yeah.
You know, I look forward to more commentary and videos explaining. Lord knows that we need I'm hoping that when the game comes out, when it goes into full release, that they will have a good tutorial, you know, step-by-step guide on how to play.
Yeah, it's one of those things where when I got into got into the Shardcast. I mentioned this when I was on Aaron Squire's show last night. It, the whole, my whole thing for it was, when I first started listening to the cast and all that stuff, it was during the was it the Magic Olympics where it was last year, and the casting just went way over my head because I was still very much a casual player, and I was just, why am I even listening to this? I'm not even, I can't even follow along. So when I tried to do my casting. no matter who's listening to it should be able to follow along. That's my goal, at least. Yeah. Maybe someone will learn something. Who knows? But as my wife said, it kept me in the house on Friday night last night instead of out running a mecca through town. So I guess in some weird convoluted way, it makes me a good husband too. Who knows? So we'll keep with that. All right. So you put up the big GG after the expletive. After the expletive.
Yeah.
So now let's see your
what. I was like, I was going to make him play it out, and then I remembered, oh, yeah, this stupid Urnaz bug. I'm done. I just concede. Like, I was like, all right, I'm going to swing. Ugh. Now, stupid Urnaz bug.
Is your cam not turned on?
Deal with that.
Is your cam not turned on? I know it wasn't turned on while we were doing that, when you came back on.
Oh, man.
Turn it back on.
Yeah, it did not. It did disconnect, didn't it?
Mm-hmm.
There we go. All right. I didn't realize it disconnected. It turned off whenever we got disconnected earlier.
Okay, let's see if I can't pull that back up.
Get to see. I'm trying to figure out a way to get my green screen
there we
to
go.
Work in Skype.
There we go. I got you.
I'd like it. I'd like to have my green screen.
Oh, yeah. I love that green screen. I can't do it in the room I'm casting in. Well, if you've noticed, if you watch any of my cast, half the time I've got two dogs running around. So they just knock it over anyway.
Yeah.
So at this point in time, I don't even know. I thought
about. I have mine pinned up on the wall.
Okay.
So like I pinned it. I used some thumbtacks and put it up on the wall. So it's a wall behind me. It's not like, you know.
Gotcha.
It's not hanging on.
I don't know. So. I don't know if the wife would be too keen about covering up the pictures with the green sheet.
Well, that's what's great. That's what's great about, you know, being single in your own house.
Oh, sure.
And stuff. You get to do whatever you want to.
Now, I did convince her that we've got another room in the house that has my poker table in it. That used to be like my main room, but I don't have people over to play poker anymore, so it just sits there. I told her if this ever went like big time or semi big time, I want to do my cast from in there, put a green screen up so I can put like a SharkCast logo behind me or something. That'd be pretty cool. But
yeah,
he said we'll cross that bridge when we get there. So
I'll make me like a little spoof YouTube, and I'll take the keep shot. And I'll dress up as like a reporter. I'll be like, I'm reporting here, in. Where is it? What's the location again for Hex?
I want to say Azoria, but that's Final Fantasy.
Oh man!
Oh good lord!
Man,
we are so fail.
Throw me for a loop.
We are so fail.
Where?
This
is why we have
you know
live people though. They're supposed to like chime in.
Hold on,
hey,
I'll have it for you in 2 seconds.
That place.
Intrath.
All right.
Intrath.
Okay.
That's what it is.
Hey, I'm reporting live at the Keep of King. Oh man, God! Making references. What's the guy? Cost six.
King Gabriel. Wolf? King Gabriel.
Yeah, King. I'm here at King Gabriel's castle, reporting to you live.
We are getting mocked right now on the channel, just in case you wondered. But that's good.
Man, you should.
Who cares?
Doing a podcast, that's the worst because you're speaking off the top of your head, and then you just throw it out there to everybody, and they start writing in. Are you serious? Are you serious? You can't remember the name of that blah blah.
Right.
It's easy. It's just like
easy.
You were talking about when you're watching the games.
Right.
Like you can see how stuff is because you're not in that moment.
All right.
You know. Yes. When I'm editing the podcast, yes, I'm shaking my head at the fact that we didn't know right then.
I can't believe we didn't know that. We know
off
that
the
card.
Top of our head.
The best part is cards, because I know between the four of you, and I usually it's a rare sight when all four of you get on nowadays, but between at least three of you, you think one of you remember the card name. But it's just like it goes just out the window.
Yeah. It just hits you and it's gone. You know?
All right. Well, let's do a little bit of wrap up here, because I don't want to keep you much longer. This has been a lot of fun. I do want to give a shout out to those people who hung out with us tonight inside the channel there. So I want to thank each and every one of you for hanging out with us. Hope we were entertaining, if nothing else. But more or less, I wanted to make sure that this Inside the Shards type segment was fun and entertaining. I personally like knowing what the player was thinking as they were going through the process. I think it's helpful in the learning process. I can always assume what you're thinking as I'm doing my shard cast, but to hear it right from the player is a unique perspective. So I really appreciate you coming on and doing that for us.
Yeah, I was playing that round, I was like, oh, I should start like I wanted to make a mental note. I kept forgetting that I need to click on the cards and zoom in on them so that it would be better for you. So that when you go, oh, okay, he's going to play Thunderbird, I would like zoom in on it and, you know. So, you know, when you say it, it would show up over on the right and people would know or in front of me.
Sure.
So I'm going to try to make more of a mental note for that.
Yeah, if you want to pick up mine. By all means, if you don't mind me picking up yours, I'll continue to pick yours up in the future. But that's not at all necessary if you forget. Yeah. I've gotten pretty good at knowing the card art now, though. So, but yeah, if you remember, that's great. But,
well, it's better. It's better for the viewers, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So that when you say Thunderbird, you know, there's the picture of the Thunderbird. Like that's something I can't wait. I would love to see you progress further with Shardcast and develop a UI for when you're doing it on the fly. To possibly bring up the card on the right side or in the upper corner.
That. Do I still have that down here? I had it down here at one point in time. What I did, and we tried it in the very first Shardcast, I think it was, when Cog and I did it. In between matches, or maybe this is one I did on my own. Either way, between matches when I was trying to kill time, I had another layout that looked very similar to what I'm casting, but instead of having my webcam in the bottom, it actually had a picture of the card I was talking about. The difficulty of that is because I have to upload the image each time. So I'm sitting here clicking, trying to find the next card I'm talking about, save it, replace the image and all that stuff within, you know, a matter of, you know, 10 seconds. Try talking my wife into being my little producer. She gave me the, you're funny. So, but yeah, I mean, if that becomes at all possible.
Are you using XSplit or Open Broadcaster?
I'm using Open Broadcaster. Only because that way I can
maybe
get a
bigger...
Maybe
you could just, like, keep... I was thinking maybe you could keep, like, a...
I had another...
Like, set up a region with, like, a window capture for, like, HexTCG browser or whatever. You know, one of those car database
sites.
Yeah,
I've thought about doing that, too.
So that...
That should work.
I would definitely, like... But I would definitely like to see that. Like, I was going to start, you know, looking at... Star City Games for Magic, maybe Channel Fire, the way Magic is being covered right now and all these tournaments and stuff, and try to get a feel for how their UIs are set up and how, you know, how they stream and whatnot. Like, that's what I really look forward to is when we start doing these tournaments and we have, like, deck lists possibly.
Right.
People, you know, can submit deck lists and you can cover those and, like, post those up and then, you know, talk about certain key cards and that.
I'm hoping that when they get the observer mode in, I should be able to go in and just click on the card myself and bring it up. I'm hoping. Mm-hmm. Now,
I would definitely love to see that.
That would be huge for me, at least. That way I could say, hey, I'm talking about they just drew this, and right click on it, and it's on the screen for me.
Yeah.
So, but I like your idea of grabbing the Windows shot of the TCG browser. I might have to try to do that. What else were we talking about the other day? Oh, I was talking about putting maybe a observer chat instead of having had the usual game chat. Having in the observer having observer chat, because I don't know about you, but when I was playing Magic Online, which their name, whatever, Magic Online, and even playing different card games online like through Yahoo Games and stuff, if people were observing, they'd sit there and blow up the chat. Whereas it was tough to converse back and forth with your opponent if they're blowing up your chat. So this way, the observers can have their own chat. I can be the observer. We can use the observer chat as the real-time chat for the cast and go that route. But that may be asking a little too much. Who knows? We can always dream. But I do, like I said, I want to thank you for coming on. I want to give another shout-out to Threshold Podcast real quick, because I've been listening to you guys since, I think, episode 9 or 10. And you guys absolutely, I look forward to it on Tuesday mornings. I should be focusing on work, but I put you guys up in the background and listen to you. And I'm laughing at my desk, and people are giving me weird looks, but that's okay. So tell everybody again what Threshold Podcast is all about. Real briefly.
Threshold Podcast. It's 90% about Hex. Usually the opening banter is pretty, you know, maybe like 5 to 10 minutes of just ramblings.
Sure.
But we cover pretty much what has happened. Since we come out on Mondays, mm-hmm. we pretty much cover what has happened the week before. Mm-hmm. I would really like it if we could cover, so we might miss out on like the Friday update.
Right.
Usually we can't cover what has happened with the patch that has come out the previous week.
Okay.
And we also talk about, we have a card of the week. We also listen to, we read our listener mail, and we also cover some stuff that's on Reddit and also in the forums and on Twitter.
Okay.
We're just all about Hex. Also, I guess you should probably say that Hex TCG Pro is going to come out with a podcast. Are you pretty excited about that?
Yes, actually.
I haven't really caught their webcast stuff.
No, the webcast I've caught a couple times, and actually I was mentioning on Aaron Squire's show last night that this will actually be more beneficial for me. Their casts are usually like 9 or 10 o'clock at night Eastern time, and I'm usually heading towards the bed at that point in time. It's a little late for me to set for an hour-long show.
Yeah.
So by them going to a podcast, I can do the same thing I do with you guys. Listen to it while I'm at work, while I'm on the drive to work, whenever, get access to it. I hope to see you guys kind of do almost... I don't want to see you guys do the same thing. That's the thing, because I know that you guys do a wonderful job, and I know that they're not... John Tata, who's the guy spearheading Hex TCG Pro, is not out there to cannibalize anything. So
yeah,
he wants to make sure his content is just
good.
Yeah,
I told him he's probably going to be covering the PvP scene a lot more than we probably ever will.
Yeah,
we'll probably dabble in it, but we won't be covering. They'll probably go a lot more in depth with like top eight stuff and like key cards and stuff like that than we probably ever will.
You guys may be in those top eight, so who knows? That could be something in your future. Maybe if you don't stop playing.
Yeah, hopefully.
Stop playing in fear when you play, you might make it to top eight. Who knows?
Yeah. Hmm.
Yeah, I know.
No,
yeah.
No, I'm like, skimming the cut. But then once I get into that top round, I just lose immediately. I would get like top 32. Mm-hmm. I make it at 32. First round to lose.
Oh, that's no good. That's no good. Well, if you guys look to the right of Outlandish Matt right there, you see his Twitter handle, at Outlandish Matt. Please follow him on Twitter. You see mine, at Fritzylvania. Follow me on my Hex Shardcast YouTube channel to the left there, youtube.com/user/HexShardcast. Follow also, is it at ThresholdCast, correct? That's the Threshold's handle.
That is correct.
Okay, so make sure you...
That is correct. ThresholdCast.
At ThresholdCast. Make sure you follow that as well. When I post this to YouTube, I'm going to have links to all of Outlandish Matt's Twitter and Twitch and that sort of thing. I'm also going to have links to the Threshold Podcast stuff. So make sure you follow along with them. Subscribe to their YouTube. Not their Twitter. Make sure you follow them each and every week when they put out a podcast. Is that pretty much now on Tuesdays? Is that where we're going to go out Tuesday mornings? I know for a while it was Monday or Tuesday.
Pretty much Monday nights. If I wasn't so lazy, I'd get it out sooner.
Again, but, that honesty from you. Hey, honesty. You gotta sell it.
I have to put out. I have to compile three different streams into one stream. Mm-hmm. So it can be a little daunting just sitting down for like an hour and a half, 2 hours to listen to it and edit it, and it's mm-hmm. just. It's one of those things where you're like, it's the weekend.
Right. You say that. I do my best work on the weekends.
Yeah. And I don't know if you're like me, where it's like crunch time. You're like, okay, last minute resort. And that's when I get all my stuff done, like studying for exams, getting work done,
sure.
cleaning up the house. It's not until 2 hours before people are going to come over to the house or something.
Oh, of course. What is that? The Flight of the Bumblebee running in the background of your head while you're trying to go through the house and clean up real quick. But
right.
But yeah, definitely.
But so expect them out Mondays to Tuesday mornings, whenever you're going to get up or something.
Okay. And I'll try to also get a make sure I'll get that from you when we get done here. The credentials as far as the email addresses and that sort of thing, because I want to put that up there as well.
Sure.
Because the guys over at Threshold are very good at answering listener email. So make sure you email in if you have questions, tweet them, make comments on their website. They put the podcast on the website, have some good content on there. All their podcasts and previous podcasts can be found on there. And you're up to, what, 25 episodes now? You guys are getting up there.
Yeah, it's about right. Yeah, 25, I think.
Yeah, so you've got about 24, 25 hours worth of content there to listen to and get caught up on the progression from Hex from the beginning of Alpha all the way to where we're at now, as well as the banter and the frustration that Matt has each and every podcast with one single card. It usually changes from week to week, but he usually has a frustration with a single card. So I do want to thank you again, Matt, and I appreciate you stopping by. Hang on, I'm going to debrief you when we get done here, but I'm going to say to everyone else, this is the 27th episode of Shardcast. I appreciate you for stopping in and viewing, and until next time, so long. Yourself.